In this video, we'll apply the workflow we covered earlier, the building and running a new DIRCAM model. This simple case study will help introduce you to using and navigating the DIRCAM desktop user interface, and also serve as the starting point for more advanced DIRCAM model options and features introduced in subsequent videos. For now, this video will cover starting a new single node project, importing and modifying reference data, running a reference case, then setting up and running your investment case. This is the screen you should see when first launching your DIRCAM desktop application. If you see something that looks substantially different, that likely means you're using an older version of the interface, in which case some of the information presented in this video will not match up one-to-one to your application. At this point, you should be somewhat familiar with the workflow diagram shown here, which provides a useful roadmap for using the tool. From here, we'll simply select New Project, which then presents us with a menu for creating our new project and importing data from the reference libraries. First, give your project a name. Once saved, the project files will be located in your documents directory, so we recommend using a naming convention that helps you remember what settings and data each project contains. Once that's complete, you'll select either a single or multi-node project and the version of the DIRCAM optimization engine you'd like to use. The UI typically restricts you to only creating models using the latest version of DIRCAM, which is currently version 5.9. For this case study, we're going to be using reference data for our building loads, solar data, and energy tariffs. The building loads data library contains data from reference building energy models that were developed by the US Department of Energy to be representative of 16 general building types in 16 US cities that correspond to US climate zones as seen in this map. If you're trying to model a US location that isn't included in the DIRCAM load data library, we recommend using the map to determine which climate zone your project site is in, then pick the city that corresponds to that climate zone. That will ensure that the building properties or building code requirements match your project location. At the moment, the data library only contains locations within the US. However, users with non-US projects can import their own load data after they've created their new model. The last options box allows you to pick the building vintage, new construction, or existing stock built before or after 1980. Building vintage affects building properties and system efficiencies and ultimately the shape of the different load profiles. Once building properties have been selected, users can scale the load profiles to match total annual consumption of electricity and natural gas. The resulting load profiles for each end use, month, and design day are plotted on the right. Next, we'll select our reference solar data. These profiles represent the typical hourly insolation for a location based on historical data. The TMY3 dataset is based on the most recent set of historical data, so we recommend using that. Again, reference data is limited to US locations, but we are able to provide a much larger and more geographically detailed set of US locations. The final step in the new project menu is to import tariff data for electricity and fuel. We offer a limited set of generic tariffs for each of the 16 US reference cities used in the load database. These tariffs are meant to be representative, but since rates change often, they may not be fully up to date. For real-world projects, we recommend users confirm current rates and update their models accordingly. After tariff settings have been selected, press Apply and wait as the new model is constructed. Once the new model is ready, you'll see a new home screen that provides detailed guidance on the general DIRCAM workflow. If you need to, you can always return to this screen by clicking Home in the top or side menu. Referring to the workflow diagram, we can see that the new project menu has essentially allowed us to complete steps 1 through 3 of building a new model. Let's confirm the state of our model by checking some of the basic options. First, if we navigate to Global Model Options, Optimization Settings, we can see that Minimize Cost is selected by default. You can find more detailed descriptions of the currently selected input parameters in the right pane. If we navigate to Solar Insolation, we can see that the solar profiles from our selected location have populated this table. If needed, we can update or modify this data, but for now we'll leave it as is. Similarly, we can check and update the load profile data generated for our project. If you'd like to use custom profiles generated from your own historical interval data, you can use a tool on our website to help create design day load profiles formatted for DIRCAM from standard 8760 hourly data. But again, for now, we'll leave the reference data as is. Finally, the imported tariff data is distributed across a number of different tables inside the utility menu. If we navigate to the General Data Tariff Component Selection menu, we can see which billing components will be applied to our project. Here we see only time of use energy charges, monthly demand charges, flat fuel rates, service fees for fuel and electricity are applied, along with hourly rates for any exported energy. We'll talk more about export options in a bit. All other utility cost components are disabled and will not apply to energy costs. We can examine and modify the exact rates used for energy and power in the other utility menu tables. The next step in the workflow is to define DER options and parameters. For this use case, we're just going to use default cost and performance data for each DER, so we won't modify any tables within the Distributed Energy Resources menu. With these inputs set, our next step is to run a reference case, which represents the project site before any new DER investments. Since we have no existing DERs to define for this case study, we just need to save our project, which takes a moment, then run the model. Running the model sends your project data to the DIRCAM optimization engine running on our server. This can take up to a couple minutes depending on the complexity of your model and the traffic on our server. If your model gets stuck on this step for longer than 10 minutes, it could mean something is wrong. Please contact us at dircam@lbl.gov if this is a consistent issue for your models. Once the model solves, you'll be taken to the results dashboard. Now, for our reference case, there isn't much useful information here yet, but we can use top-line values for total annual energy costs and CO2 emissions to constrain and calibrate our next set of optimizations. So make note of the values presented here, and we'll move on to running our investment case. Navigate to the Global Model Options, Financial Settings, and update the base case values for cost and CO2. Next, move to Investment Settings to globally enable DER investments by type. For this model, we'll enable generators, solar, and storage types. We will select specific technologies within each of these types in the next step. We'll move now to the DER menu. Starting with solar, we can see that technologies have two major input data tables. Techno-economic data, which defines costs and performance of the technology, and investment options, which govern how new investments can be made. By default, all specific DER technologies are disabled. The options for specifying investments are as follows. When the fixed invest parameter is enabled, the model must adopt the capacity listed under forced investment capacity. So here, when fixed invest is set to 1 and forced capacity is set to 0, that means the specific technology is effectively turned off. We can enable the technology and allow DIRCAM to select its capacity by switching fixed investment to 0. If we want the model to invest in a specific capacity, we can keep fixed invest set to 1 and set forced investment capacity to whatever capacity we need. If we want to force the model to invest in a minimum capacity, we can add a forced capacity but set fixed invest to 0. The model is free to add capacity beyond the forced amount if it helps improve the optimization objective. Finally, we can model an existing DER asset by defining a forest investment capacity and enabling the existing field. For existing assets, the initial capital cost will not be included in the total cost calculations. For our case study, we'll just enable PV without any forest investments. Moving on to energy storage, we can see additional tables that define options specific to storage technologies, and again, variable cost values within the techno-economic data menu. As we did with PV, we'll enable conventional battery storage and cold thermal storage by switching the fixed invest option to zero inside the energy storage investment options menu. Next, we'll enable some conventional continuous duty DG units. The techno-economic table includes a number of generic generator and CHP units along with their costs and performance data. For this case study, we'll give the model the option to adopt technologies 2 through 6, and to ensure some interesting results, we'll force it to adopt one unit of generator 1. Before running our case, let's check a few minor options. In our DER menu, navigate to General Constraints. For this case study, check to see that Allow PV Curtailment is enabled. This isn't required, but if you selected different input options, your model solution might vary from the one presented here. Next, we're going to enable exports from PV. Under Utility, Power Export Options, we'll enable net metering and exports from renewable sources. The net metering option sets the export price to the retail rate and prevents the site from exporting more than it imports over the course of the year. With these two minor changes made, we're again ready to save and run our model. When our solved model is returned to us, we see our results dashboard is much more data-rich than when we ran our base case. We can see our top-line savings versus our real reference case, as well as detailed plots for energy costs, emissions, electricity by source, CapEx for new investments, and new DER capacities. At the bottom, we can see additional metrics for cost, energy, and emissions with descriptions for each. The results dashboard also provides detailed plots showing energy dispatch during each month and design day. And finally, the detailed results page shows the full dataset returned from the server. If you've saved your project prior to running, this file exists as a CSV in your DIRCAM project directory and can be opened and modified using Excel or other programs. That about covers the basic process of building a DIRCAM model using the desktop interface. There are, of course, numerous different options and variations that can be added to this simple model, but we'll leave that to you to explore on your own. In the next video, we'll build directly on this existing model to show you how you can introduce grid outages and develop DER designs specifically for resilience. We'll also be putting together case study videos on building DIRCAM models for carbon minimization, off-grid systems, and multi-node models.